My name is Frank Haferkorn, and I welcome you to this lightning talk Klaus just said. Talk is about a compound group loop I invented, and you can contact me either by this GitHub site or via this email. It's on all slides. The document is sectioned into an introduction, a syntax, an implementation, examples, and the discussion of pro and contras of the compound group loop. So what is the compound group? What's the target of this talk? It's about a possible core language extension for the C++ programming language and perhaps for the C programming language too. And I want to start a discussion about a new compound statement related to simple iteration based on the compound 4 implemented with the CPP preprocessor. In general, compounds are these statements that may take a block statement behind them, like if, switch, for, do while, or while, for example. The idea is to reduce the degree of freedom of a for compound statement to allow simpler form of iterations. For example, if you have the task to iterate over, have a matrix field and you want to iterate over 4 rows, over 10 columns, and then do a block statement or a simple statement, you can use this construct. The syntax of the complete implementation looks like this. Each of these compounds has a mandatory field, the repetitions, the rep field. It says that this block statement here behind here is repeated. This number should be an integral integer. Rep times, and after each repetition, these post expressions, these optional post expressions, are executed. So this example I just showed you before might look like this: loop 4, loop 10, comma, and then follows the numbers of post expressions. The second compound I want to introduce is a named loop up or a named loop down, which takes the same mandatory field, the count of repetitions, and the optional post expression list. And an ID field that allows a simple name of a known index variable. What I just have to forgot is, wait, the loop statement uses a hidden index variable, while the named loop up and named loop down uses accessible known index variables. So for example, a named loop up could identify a symbol, the index counter index, and repeat it and repetitions and use the index variable in the block statement. The type loop has the same semantics as a loop statement with one extension. It allows a type constraint on the hidden index variable. So you can, if you are sure that you don't get an overflow or underflow, you can force the type of the iteration of the hidden iteration value to, for example, a character type. The implementation was done like this. These are the prerequisites we need for the defining them. This macro here, CPP macro unique ID, simply constructs from the line number and the counter a C symbol with this header here that is used in this CPP macro n times up example, for example, as a unique index name. So you can write a loop statement several in one line and don't have to bother about the index name because it's hidden. The counting up macro, this CPP macro n times up macro, is a very simple for statement mapping, it pipes through the type, the index name, assigns the index name to zero, and counts up to number of repetitions. And this here is the CPP preprocessor syntax for allowing optional variadic arguments. There is the same macro for looping downwards. This has works almost the same as the counting upwards. The exception is that you have to beware of unsigned types. An unsigned type would here be not smaller than zero, and this condition would never be reached. So this would lead to infinite loops. So you have to make the type signed. So the loop itself then uses this prerequisites counting up, exactly like the type loop. It applies the type of the number of repetitions using decal type to the index variable, and uses the CPP macro unique ID as the name of the index variable, so it is hidden. And then it iterates over n repetitions and the optional post expressions. The CPP macro n times up is used to utilize the typed loop here and here. The named loop up is implemented using the macro n times up and n times down. I have to force a little bit of time. And the example, I only prepared one example. It's not about what it really does. It's not about a tricky implementation, how to copy a matrix. It's about to demonstrate how the loop statement could be used. For example, if you want to take this block statement, copying source to target, looping it at n columns type, and looping each row, and after each column you increase the target point and the source pointer, and then for each row you apply the stride. This is an example how it works. The advantage is that these could be these are integral values, and they could be easily put into a local registers of the CPU. Here's the discussion. The basic facts: we are talking of the loop type loop and named loop up or down compounds. They are all implemented using the CPP preprocessor. It reduces the degree of freedom of the for compound statement. It's only a tiny extension, I have to admit that. And it's already implemented with one compilation caveat I have to tell. The readability is an advantage because due to the reduced code size, the readability is improved. And for algorithmic argument, it allows or leads the developers to notate code that is not depending on the iteration syntax. Nevertheless, teachability is, in my eyes, an argument, because teaching a for statement, then you would need assignment, the concept of variables, then you need a Boolean algebra, and you need a condition and an increment. And that's a little bit heavy for, especially for a younger audience. I think about pupils in the 6th or 8th or 10th grade, something like that. The loop opens the door to further optimization. This is not implemented in current compilers, but a regular loop statement is at least as fast as a regular for iteration. And it has more iterative flexibility for the compiler to the reduced degree of freedom. For example, it allows hardware-accelerated loops like the TMS320, the software pipeline loops, or the fast register operations for the ADSP218. This is the compiling caveat I have. Due to the compiler, to the preprocessor limitations, it's only about having templates that contain commas. So when you use a generate an int of 10 using this construct, it will fail because this comma is identified as a separating of this argument and that argument. But there's a workaround by embracing it with regular braces. As expected, a looping around an enum doesn't work. This is exactly what is expected. That was my talk. Thank you very much. You will find more information on the link I already is already presented at the CPP of the MOOC++ website. Thank you very much.